the reorganization meeting of the planning board to order for our first meeting of 2017. Just to let the members of the public know, since this is our reorganization meeting, we technically do not have a chairman until we elect one. So until that time, I'll be acting as the temporary chairperson. So Eileen, if we could read the opening statement.
Sure. Planning board meeting Thursday, January 5th, 2017. I hereby declare this meeting of the Howell Township Planning Board to be open, adequate notice having been given pursuant to the New Jersey Open Public Meeting Act in the following manner. First, on December 9th, 2016, a copy of said notice was mailed to the Asbury Park Press. Second, on December 9th, 2016, a copy of said notice was hand-delivered to the clerk of the Township of Howell. Third, on December 9th, 2016, said notice was posted in the office of the Planning Board and on the bulletin board in the Howell Township Municipal Building, 4567 Route 9, Howell Township, New Jersey. Special notice in accordance with the Fire Prevention Code. In accordance with the Fire Prevention Code and your safety, please be advised that this facility is designed with two emergency exits, which are on your right at the front and rear of the meeting room. Furthermore, smoking is not permitted in the municipal building. Please take note that this meeting is being videotaped for possible future broadcast on Howell Township TV 77.
Okay. Have our new members already been sworn in, or does anybody need to take their oath still and be sworn in?
Yes.
Okay. So anyone who needs to have their oaths or take their oaths, please stand.
Do you have a copy?
Of the oath, yes.
Yes.
I had it here. Thank you.
Okay, if you could please raise your right hand. I state your name.
I,
do solemnly swear or affirm.
Do solemnly swear or affirm.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of New Jersey.
And the Constitution of the State of New Jersey.
And that I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same.
And I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same.
And to the governments established in the United States.
The governments established in the United States.
And in this state.
Under the authority of the people.
So help me God.
So help me God.
I do further solemnly swear.
I do further solemnly swear.
That I will impartially.
I will impartially.
And justly.
And justly.
Perform all the duties of the office of planning board.
Perform all the duties of the office of planning board.
According to the best of my ability.
According to the best of my ability.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations.
If all the members could please sign that oath and return it to me.
Okay, Eileen, so if we can have our roll call.
Sure. Mayor Gatto?
Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Husser?
Here.
Chief Kudrick?
Present, ma'am.
Mr. Nash?
Here.
Mr. Russo?
Here.
Mr. Tannenhaus has been excused. Mr. French?
Here.
Mr. Boyle?
Here.
Deputy Mayor Nicastro?
Here.
Mayor Berger?
Here.
And Chairman Schneider?
Here.
Hey, if everyone can please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance and a moment of silent reflection. And our first matter of business at the reorganization meeting will be nominations for chairman for 2017.
I'd like to make a motion to nominate Paul Schneider as chairman.
I'll second.
Is there any discussion? Okay, can you please call the roll?
Mayor Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Husser?
Yes.
Chief Kudrick?
Yes.
Mr. Nash?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. French?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Nicastro?
Yes.
Mayor Berger?
Yes.
Chairman Schneider? Motion carries.
Okay. So, Chairman, it's your meeting.
A second.
Did you make a motion for Bob Nash?
I'll second the motion.
Roll call, please.
Mayor Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Husser?
Yes.
Chief Kudrick?
Yes.
Mr. Nash?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. French?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Nicastro?
Yes.
Mayor Berger?
Yes.
Chairman Schneider?
Yes. Thank you. We have a motion for secretary. Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion for Eileen Rubano as our secretary.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mayor Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Husser?
Yes.
Chief Kudrick?
Yes.
Mr. Nash?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. French?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Nicastro?
Yes.
Mayor Berger?
Yes.
Chairman Schneider?
Yes.
Thank you.
A motion for consulting attorney for Howell Township Planning Board.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion of Ron Cachero of the firm of Wiener Law Group.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mayor Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Husser?
Yes.
Chief Kudrick?
Yes.
Mr. Nash?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. French?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Nicastro?
Yes.
Mayor Berger?
Yes.
Chairman Schneider?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Thank you.
A motion for consulting engineer for the Howell Township Planning Board.
I would like to motion Laura Newman of the firm CME Associates.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mayor Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Husser?
Yes.
Chief Kudrick?
Yes.
Mr. Nash?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. French?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Nicastro?
Yes.
Mayor Berger?
Yes.
Chairman Schneider?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Motion for our consulting planner for the Howell Township Planning Board.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to motion Jennifer Beam of the firm of CME Associates.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mayor Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Husser?
Yes.
Chief Kudrick?
Yes.
Mr. Nash?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. French?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Nicastro?
Yes.
Mayor Berger?
Yes.
Chairman Schneider?
Yes.
Motion carries.
A motion for our certified tree expert.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to motion Sherry Spiro of the firm of CME Associates.
Second, please.
Second.
Roll call.
Mayor Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Husser?
Yes.
Chief Kudrick?
Yes.
Mr. Nash?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. French?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Nicastro?
Yes.
Mayor Berger?
Yes.
Chairman Schneider?
Yes.
Motion carries.
A motion for our administrative officer.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to motion Eileen Rubano for administrative officer.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mayor Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Husser?
Yes.
Chief Kudrick?
Yes.
Mr. Nash?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. French?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Nicastro?
Yes.
Mayor Berger?
Yes.
Chairman Schneider?
Yes.
Motion carries. Thank you.
A motion to approve a resolution for our 2017 meeting dates.
Recording secretary.
Oh, recording secretary. Motion, please, to appoint our recording secretary.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to motion Eileen Rubano for recording secretary.
Absolutely. Second, please.
Second.
Roll call.
Mayor Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Husser?
Yes.
Chief Kudrick?
Yes.
Mr. Nash?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. French?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Nicastro?
Yes.
Mayor Berger?
Yes.
And Chairman Schneider?
Yes.
Resolutions memorial, motion carries. Thank you.
A resolution of approval for 2017 meeting dates.
Before we do the dates, I just want to make sure September 21st should be our second meeting. However, that's Rosh Hashanah, so September the 14th, okay with everyone?
Yes.
Thank you.
Was that what you distributed the last time?
Yes.
We don't need to vote on this.
Do you want to vote?
Yes, please, so I can advertise for the meetings.
Roll call, please.
We need a motion.
Motion and a roll call.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion to approve the 2017 meeting dates as distributed at last board meeting.
And memorialize the resolution?
And memorialize it also.
Thank you.
I'll second.
Roll call, please.
Mayor Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Husser?
Yes.
Chief Kudrick?
Yes.
Mr. Nash?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. French?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Castro?
Yes.
Mayor Berger?
Yes.
Chairman Schneider?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Make a motion to approve the Tri-Town News as our official newspaper.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make that motion that Tri-Town News will be our official newspaper.
I think you've typically in the past have done the Tri-Town News and the Asbury Park Press. For applicants, it's a little easier because the Tri-Town News is a weekly, so for them to get their notices in the paper, oftentimes it's easier for them to do it in a daily. So you don't have to pick one or the other. You could still pick Tri-Town if you want, I'm just telling you what you've done historically, and it's more beneficial to people who need to notice.
Can we make a motion for Tri-Town News and Tri-Ledger?
You can make for whatever you want.
Well, I'll make that motion then, Tri-Town News and Star-Ledger.
I'll second.
Roll call, please.
Mayor Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Husser?
Yes.
Chief Kudrick?
Yes.
Mr. Nash?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. French?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Castro?
Yes.
Mayor Berger?
Yes.
Chairman Schneider?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Our Environmental Commission liaison is Mr. Nicholas Huzar?
Husser.
Husser. Mr. Nicholas Husser. I'm going to appoint to our Site Review Committee Chairman Thomas Boyle, Mr. Nicholas Huzar, and Mr. Ken French. To Tom Boyle's chairman. Master Plan Review Committee Chairman, Mr. Thomas Russo, Mr. Robert Nash, and Mr. Brian Tannenhouse. Thank you. First thing I'd like to do is we have three members that are not with us from last year. Our Master Plan Chairman, Mr. Arthur Frankhauser, and who was also our liaison from the Environmental Commission, and Art did a great job. Those of you know, his wife is also the member of the Regional High School Board of Education. And he's been a hard worker, and he's certainly going to be missed. Tom O'Donnell, my friend, got appointed to the Board of Adjustment, so he's going to do a great job on the Board of Adjustment. And we're going to miss George Gravatt, which was our township liaison, we're not going to have a great replacement for George with our chief of police, but...
great, thanks.
But George was welcome addition to our planning board, had a tremendous amount of expertise, especially having to do with roads and such. And we're going to miss George, and hopefully we're going to still reach out to George for lots of information and help in the future. I just for the edification of some people that don't know too much about our planning board. This is my 13th year on the planning board, and this is my fourth year as chairman, and I want to thank you all for this great honor. We've sat through in these 13 years two master plans, continuous update of our master plan. We're now working and finalizing a recreation element of the master plan. During that period, we've enacted design standards on all commercial buildings and highway development zones. And from the beginning, our emphasis was to keep the rural character of Howell Township. And I think we've done that. Occasionally, I'll run into somebody that has been away from Howell for the last 10 or 15 years. And they come back, and then they say, I can't believe this is the same lovely place with the way our development looks on the highway and our design standards. And still in all, we're keeping our rural character. So with this board, I have so much confidence that this board is going to continue every member in that direction. And if we can continue in that direction, I'll be very happy. So I want to thank everybody again. Okay, we don't have any minutes. Do we have some correspondence, please?
Yes, we do. I have a letter from Frank Accazano. He is the attorney for 352 Monmouth Road, LLC, which was on tonight's agenda. He has asked that we carry this application to the second meeting in March, which would be March the 16th, with no further notice. He has also given the board an extension of time to act on the application through April 30th, 2017. Do we want to carry that?
Is that amenable to you, Mr. Chairman? All right, so the application of 352 Monmouth Road, LLC, case number SD-2975, be carried to the board's March 16th, 2017 meeting, 7 o'clock here at Town Hall. There will be no further notice to property owners.
I also have a letter from Stephen Gowen, who is the attorney for MGD Holdings, which is on tonight's agenda as well. He has asked that we carry this application to January 19th, 2017, and he will renotice for that meeting. And he has also granted an extension of time for the board to act through February 2017.
Okay. So since there's a renotice for that, we don't have to formally carry it tonight.
And the last one on the agenda is Jacqueline Palmer, and I have an email from the attorney for that application. There was a problem with the notice, as Farmingdale did not get their certified list back, so they are renoticing, and so they are going to be moved to January 19th as well, and they have also granted an extension of time to February 28th.
Again, since they're renoticing, we don't have to make a formal announcement for that.
And that's it on correspondence. Thank you.
Mr. Cachero, the three resolutions are all okay?
Two resolutions. Oh, actually, the third resolution is supposed to be for our next meeting. I just got it to you early, and I'm still talking to the applicant's attorney about it. So that one, the Boulder resolution, is on for the next meeting.
Okay, so just take that out.
Yeah.
Okay, so we do have a resolution, two resolutions, case number SD-2969. Binion Holdings, LLC, Larrabee 1501, resolution granting preliminary major subdivision. Eligible voters are Mr. Nash, Mr. French, Mr. Boyle, Stigato, and myself. Can I have a motion to memorialize?
I'll make a motion to approve.
I'll second it.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Nash?
Yes.
Mr. French?
Yes.
Mr. Boyle?
Yes.
Mayor Gatto?
Yes.
Chairman Schneider?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Case number SD-2977, Jacqueline Palmer, resolution granting submission waivers. Eligible voters, Mr. Nash, Mr. Russo, Mr. French, Mr. Boyle, Deputy Mayor Nicastro, Mr. Gatto, and myself.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion granting the submission waivers for case number SD-2977.
I'll second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Nash?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. French?
Yes.
Mr. Boyle?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Nicastro?
Yes.
Mayor Gatto?
Yes.
And Chairman Schneider?
Yes.
Resolution's memorialized.
First application before the board this evening is case number SD-2970A, Girl Scouts of the Jersey Shore. It's an amended minor subdivision. It's application of Girl Scouts of the Jersey Shore as applicant and owner seeking amended minor subdivision approval to subdivide existing lot with a house into two lots to create a residential lot for the existing house and retain the basis, the balance of the property and consolidate with the joint lot owned by the same owner on premises known as Block 177, Lot 81, 84, 218 Adelphia Road. This application originally received approval for minor subdivision on April 21st, 2016, but would like to consolidate the balance of the lot with the adjacent Lot 8101 instead of Lot 84. Application was scheduled to be heard December 15th, was rescheduled to January 5th due to insufficient notice. Expiration date is January 6th. Counselor?
Bill Mayer, Mayor LaFrance and Williams, 10 East Main Street, Freehold, representing the applicant, the Girl Scouts of the Jersey Shore. That summary is actually the total summary of what's involved. The subdivision was previously approved and considered public hearing, but at that point we were going to take the back portion of the lot, which was created as a separate lot by the subdivision, and add it to a large piece of the Girl Scout property. We ran into problems, which Mike Geller, who's the engineer, will explain what happened doing that, and we determined that the best way to do this instead was to add that back lot to an adjacent lot the Girl Scouts owned, which is near the front of the property. That's the only change. It's where we take the residual, the remainder lot, and add it to. Both lots that would be the receiving lots are owned by the Girl Scouts already and have been for many years. So if I can, just have Mr. Geller explain and show you on the map what's involved. And we should have a couple minutes just to explain it to you.
You swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give this board is the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth?
I do.
Please state and spell your name for the record.
Michael Geller, G-E-L-L-E-R. I'm a professional engineer.
Mr. Geller, I will accept your credentials.
Look, Mr. Chair, we should at least have him put on some credentials, even though we're familiar with him, just for the record.
Yes, thank you. I'm a professional engineer since 1980 and a professional planner since 1983. I've testified before this board on numerous occasions and other boards throughout.
Thank you, Mr. Geller. I accept your credentials.
Thank you, Mr. Schneider.
Mr. Geller, can I just ask, could you move the easel closer to the podium?
Sure. The easel has the plan that was on the CD that we submitted. I'm not sure if you still use the laptops that have that, but that's what shows on the plan, and that's the proposed amended minor subdivision map. What happened, this application was approved in April of last year for the creation of two lots, subdividing Lot 81. The front portion, which is the piece fronting on Adelphia Road, has an acre in area and required a variance, which was approved. And the rear piece was in excess of 3 acres, and that was going to be subdivided with Lot 84, which is north of or to the rear of that property. We thought it was a good idea to consolidate it with Lot 84, since that's the bulk of the Girl Scouts campgrounds. However, when we went after the approval, we asked the Girl Scouts for their existing surveys of their properties, and we found that Lot 84 was one part of a 140-something acre tract that was surveyed in 2003 by French and Perillo and consisted of numerous lots, 63, 6501, 67, 8101, 82, 83, 84, 85, 102, 103, 104, and 105, and consisted of 143.65 acres. Additionally, our minor subdivision was based on a survey by Robert Euro, and this survey by French and Perillo was on a different bearing base. We were also provided the survey for Lot 84, which is the property due west of the subject property. That's the site of the Girl Scout Equestrian Center. And that property was based on another survey by Thomas Ernst and is on the same bearing base as Mr. Euro did for his minor subdivision and consisted of 7.52 acres. So technically, it was more feasible to consolidate it with that lot. Mr. Euro prepared the deed of the description that was incorporated into a deed that was eventually submitted to Mr. Savino at the Township Engineer's Office, who does the compliance reviews. And lastly, and perhaps most importantly, when one of the process of getting a minor subdivision is we submit the map to the engineer's office for their reassignment of the tax lot numbers. And when we were coordinating with Mr. Savino in that regard, he found that Lot 84, because it was consolidated with so many other lots in the area, it was more facilitated to be consolidated with 8101, and he actually issued a letter to that effect dated September 1st, 2016. That was also part of our application package and on the CD. And in that letter, he assigned the tax lot numbers that were approved for the two lots, 81.02 for the new lot with the dwelling, 8103 for the rear 3-acre lot, and then the consolidated lot with lot 8101 would be 8104. And we just need the board's approval to approve the amendment of the original resolution to consolidate it with lot 8101 instead of 84. And that's the only reason we're here tonight.
There was a lot of discussion to indicate that by doing it the old way as such would cost an extreme amount of money for the Girl Scouts in order to just get all of the bearings and what we would need to do to complete the subdivision and record it as such. The one next door is a much smaller one. It was surveyed on the same bearings, and so consequently, it is a very simple merger of the two that will be able to be recorded at an inconsequential cost to the Girl Scouts. So that's the reason.
Mr. Meyer, what's the rationale? What's the driving reason for the desire to consolidate the lots?
Because the lot in the back does not have any frontage. It needs to be consolidated with a lot that has road frontage.
The municipal land use law doesn't allow you to have to create a landlocked lot without receiving what they call a planning variance. So that would need relief for them to do that.
The purpose of the subdivision was to separate the house and the back property, as we testified to, is mainly wooded, and it was to keep it as part of the overall Girl Scout property, which acts as a very good buffer for the property and the campgrounds from the road and such. And that's what we're doing. We're maintaining that as part of our property to provide for that.
Anybody else? Thing from the board. See now, I'll open it up to the public. If there's anybody from the public that would like to comment on this application, please stand up and come forward. Seeing none, I'll close the public portion. It's your pleasure, gentlemen and lady.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion to approve the amended minor subdivision for case number SD-2970A.
Second, please.
I'll second.
Roll call.
Mayor Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Husser?
Yes.
Chief Kudrick?
Yes.
Mr. Nash?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. French?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Nicastro?
Yes.
Mayor Berger?
Yes.
And Chairman Schneider?
Yes.
Motion
Thank you very
carries.
Much.
Thank you.
Next case is case number SD-2847A2, Haystack Glen, formerly CS Realty. This is an extension of time. Application of Haystack Glen, formerly GS Realty, as applicant and owner, seeking a 2-year extension of time on a final major subdivision approval granted October 2nd, 2014, on premises known as Block 36, Lot 21, Maxim Southern Road. Expiration date is January 20th of this year.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman. Warren Fink on behalf of the applicant. I have with me one of the shareholders.
Talk
In case there are any questions I have with me, Anna Semenchuk, one of the shareholders, the chief contractor, there was a mix-up in, even though the letter advising us of this meeting was mailed on December 20th, we never received it. We just found out yesterday, and Mr. Semenchuk, who's the other shareholder, who's the main builder, he already had tickets to leave this morning to Poland. So I brought, just in case there are any questions, I did bring one of the shareholders with me, if she can answer any questions the board might have. The reason, if I may address the board, we're requesting, as your Mr. Chairman said, a 2-year extension from the approvals, which expired December 31st of 2016. The approvals were originally granted October 2nd, 2014. It's a 71.3-acre tract with 9 lots, 8 residential, 1 for open space and store management. 54 acres are left open for open land dedicated to the township. So the standard for an extension of time is set forth in NJSA 40:55D-52, and I'd just like to cite a few reasons from there, which I think justify the request for the extension. Two of the standards are the size of the project and the comprehensiveness of the development. This is a 9-lot, 71-acre project, though only, obviously, 17 acres are only actually being worked on. So it's not a small project. And also going to the issue of the comprehensiveness of the development, we're trying to get some legal pieces put into place, especially working on details concerning the detention basin, and we also need to take care of the developer's agreement. Finally, two other factors, economic conditions and also, again, the comprehensiveness of the development. Frankly, the client is finishing another project, and then he can turn his, which he'll be done with shortly, and then he can turn his full attention to this matter. So we respectfully request a 2-year extension.
Mr. Fink, do you have all of your other outside agency approvals that you need? I don't know if a county planning board approval is required for this or any state approvals. What's the status of those?
I haven't been fully involved in that aspect of it. My understanding is, I spoke to the engineer handling the project on the builder's end, and he says that almost all the engineering details have been finalized. I know that there were some easements that I'd submitted to your office about a month ago.
That's not outside agency approvals,
of just generally finishing
up. It looks like, I just checked with our engineers. They think that you've obtained all of your outside agency approvals.
Yep. Okay, thank you.
So, Mr. Chair, essentially for extensions of time, what you're looking for is that the applicant has diligently pursued the satisfying the conditions of approval. The outside agency approvals have been obtained. They're working on, as you heard, executing a developer's agreement. They've submitted some documents to my office for review recently. So they have been progressively moving forward with the project. You don't have to give 2 years. That's the maximum you can give. You can give a year or 2 years. That's a policy decision for the board.
Why do you need 2 years?
Honestly, that's what my client asked for. I mean, if it's going to be a year, I'm sure they can get it done within a year also. But I guess they'd like some more wiggle room, honestly.
A little buffer, okay.
What's that?
Yes, 2 years will be.
I think you have to be sworn in. You have to be sworn in. It's all right.
Mayor, you have something to say?
No.
I do, Mr. Chair. I'm always concerned when the board gives 2-year extensions basically because of how things change. And, I find that when an applicant starts at 2014, it's 2017, I understand the economy wasn't the best and some of the reasons you gave. But still a 2-year extension to me is a long time. I like one, and then you could always come back if you didn't. It gives the board an opportunity to see really what's going on with the application. So my recommendation, if you like, I'll make a motion for a 1-year extension.
Thank you. That sounds fair.
Do Do we have a second?
I'll second that.
Roll call, please.
Mayor Gatto?
Yes.
Mr. Husser?
Yes.
Chief Kudrin?
Yes.
Mr. Nash?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. French?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Nicastro?
Yes.
Mayor Berger?
Yes.
Chairman Schneider?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Thank you. Next application before the board is case number SP1013 SL Homes Incorporated. This is a preliminary and final major site plan, a bulk variance, and a woodlands management. Application of SL Homes Incorporated as applicant and Savina Sava as owner seeking preliminary and final major site plan with ancillary bulk variance and woodlands management plan approval to construct three commercial buildings to include a shopping center and two restaurant pads on premises known as Block 143, Lots 23 and 24, State Highway, Route 9 North, just north of Casino Drive. Application of SL Homes Incorporated was scheduled to be heard December 15th, 2016, when it was carried to this evening. Counselor?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Jan Woters. I'm a partner in the firm of Bathgate, Wagner & Wolf in Lakewood. I represent the applicant, SL Homes, Inc., in connection with this application, SP1013. This is an application for, as you stated, preliminary and final site plan approval in order to construct on the property three commercial buildings, a shopping center building, and two separate restaurant pads on property known as Block 143, Lot 23 and 24. The total square footage of all of the buildings is approximately 38,000 square feet. The property is located in the HD1 highway zone, and the uses that we are requesting are all permitted. For my first witness, I'd like to call Mr. Bruno Savo, who is the applicant.
Do you swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give this board is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Please state and spell your name for the record.
Bruno Savo, B-R-U-N-O, last name Savo, S-A-V-O.
And where do you reside, Mr. Savo?
2 Michaels Way, Colts Neck, New Jersey.
Okay. And Mr. Savo, are you a principal in the applicant SL Homes, Inc.?
Yes, I am.
Okay. And are you also in connection with your father and the owner of the property?
That's correct.
So you're both the applicant and the owner?
Yes, sir.
Would you please describe for the board generally what your plan is to develop the property?
What was specified before, shopping center building and two out parcels for restaurants. Approximately, if they were divided into the smallest units, they'd be about 15 units commercial. It also has a second floor, which is included in that square footage which you gave. It's actually a story and a half. It's not two stories. The second floor is approximately 8,000 square feet.
And do you, at this point, have any tenants for any of the buildings on the property?
No, not as of yet. We wanted to wait till approval to be able to market the property.
Okay. Mr. Savo, how long have you owned the property?
We've owned this property since 1985.
Okay. And currently the property is vacant, I understand?
Yes, it's vacant.
There are no buildings located on the property?
No buildings located on the property.
Has the property been utilized for anything during your term of ownership?
No, sir.
Okay, thank you. I have no further questions of Mr. Savo, the applicant. Does the board have any questions of Mr. Savo?
I'm sorry, I just didn't hear what you said about the second floor.
The shopping center building is primarily a one-story building. However, there is a center area which would have a mezzanine area to it. So it's not a two-story building, it's a one-story building with a mezzanine center, which will add additional square footage. They don't know what the use of that would be, but it would be in keeping with the retail use of the other potential 15 units.
Thank you.
But just, and it was a good question, Mr. Nicastro, because I want the board to understand, this is, does not cover the entire building, and you'll see that with the architecturals.
I got it.
Okay.
Isn't there, is that billboard out there, is that on your property?
Yes, sir.
And it's not vacant.
Oh, I didn't consider the billboard as occupying, I apologize.
It's vacant with a billboard.
It's sometimes hard to get rid of, aren't they?
No, we have an open lease with them, so it goes month to month at this point.
Thank you.
Board, any other questions of the applicant?
Mr. Waters, just to be clear on the record, as part of this application, the billboard would be eliminated?
The billboard would be eliminated.
Okay.
That is correct. Any other questions? Okay, Mr. Savo, thank you.
Thank you.
I'd now like to call Mr. Bill Stevens, who is our engineer.
Hey, do you swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give this board is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Please state and spell your name for the record.
William Stevens, Stevens.
Mr. Stevens, will you please state with whom you're affiliated?
Yes, I am the Vice President of Professional Design Services. I've been there for the last 20-something years. I am a professional engineer and a professional planner licensed to practice here in the state of New Jersey, and I have appeared before this board on numerous occasions.
I'll accept your credentials.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Stevens, obviously you're acquainted with the application. Didn't you, in fact, prepare the plans that have been submitted in conjunction with the application?
Yes, we did.
Okay. So let's describe first, please, for the board, the project that is being proposed, in particularly starting with the description of the property.
That's fine. The subject property is known as lots 23 and 24, block 143. It's approximately a 12.5-acre tract located along Route 9 in the HD1 zoning district. It's basically just north of Casino Drive, just to the north of the Manasquan River, and just to the south of the villages on the east side of Route 9.
And what's currently on the property?
Currently on the property, there are some dilapidated foundations on the property. There is a billboard, as was previously mentioned, but basically the site's vacant.
Okay. Is any portion of the property traversed by the Manasquan River?
It is. The property located to the south is the entire southern border of the property borders the Manasquan River. Then there's a tributary to the Manasquan River that is basically the eastern border of the property. It kind of traverses through a bit to the west of the property between the villages and the property itself. There is an upland area located in that northeast corner, but it is on the eastern side of that tributary of the Manasquan River, and the applicant is not proposing to disturb that particular area.
And you'll be testifying further as to the exact location of the wetlands areas in conjunction with the letter of interpretation?
Yes.
Okay. So if you would give a little bit more detail about how the applicant wishes to propose to develop the tract?
The applicant is seeking to develop the tract into a shopping center. The center itself would be comprised of three buildings. The main building itself would be located in the eastern portion of the site that's proposed to be developed and would be a multi-tenant retail structure. There are two pad sites located to the west of that between the main building and Route 9. The applicant is proposing a single driveway access point off of Route 9 and then parking lots and infrastructure that would traverse around the entire site.
And parking?
That's correct. There is parking located adjacent to both of the pad sites, as well as in front of the proposed retail building, with some employee parking located to the rear of the retail building.
And is a stormwater basin proposed?
Yes, there is a stormwater basin that's proposed, located along the southern boundary of the site, outside of the riparian buffer, which will ultimately discharge back to the Manasquan River.
Mr. Chair, can I just ask a question? Can we go back to parking for a second? Because in our letter dated December 5th, we noted that you calculated the parking as a shopping center, and in the professionals meeting, we advised that it should be calculated based on retail and restaurant. So did you do those parking calculations?
Mr. Stevens?
I did not personally do those calculations, Ms. Beam. We have our traffic engineer, Mr. Kennel, here, who will testify about the parking as the next witness.
Okay. Is he also going to testify about loading?
The loading, I think, is probably a better subject for myself to discuss.
I note that there's no loading spaces, no loading docks, no loading area. And I understand you don't have tenants, but you're talking about food. And generally, food comes in trucks that need an area to load.
That is correct. So going slowly through the subject of loading zones for the proposed project, the main building itself, the retail building, has a two-way drive aisle located behind it that's 30 feet in width with some employee parking. It's our intention that the main building would be loaded from the rear, and there is ample room, in my opinion, to provide for loading behind the building. We didn't on purpose stripe a loading area there because I wanted to leave the driveway two ways so that people could figure out the best way to load into their own stores and for that facility. If the board is concerned about that, the answer simply is that we would make it a one-way drive behind the building and then have a striped loading area as well. There's room for both. I mean, I think my plan functions well the way it's designed, but it could be done either way. As far as the two pad buildings go in loading, my experience in working with different types of restaurants or banks or whatever else these pad sites end up being in the future is that each company has its own means and methods for loading, and they're very, very specific. So what I would propose is that once those tenants were identified, that we would come back and be more specific about the operations of the pad sites.
But you're asking for a preliminary and final tonight, correct?
Correct.
So you'd never come back?
Right.
I think with regard to the pad sites, we could be looking for preliminary and final on the shopping center, but preliminary only on the pads.
Okay.
Because I think that's difficult too, only because you don't have tenants. So you have no designated loading area. And it's difficult to say. You might have a tenant take up multiple of these spaces that are going to need a different area to load. I don't see a configuration which shows the one-way drive aisle to the rear, but it's something for the board to consider, that there are no designated loading areas shown on the plans. The fast food pads, definitely. We all see Dunkin' Donuts likes to park on Route 9. It's a bad idea. And just with the multi-use tenant, I just find it hard to believe that there's no loading provided, and this board generally, I just think that's a detail that you would prefer to see or know of.
Don't necessarily disagree, but it's difficult to do that before you have a tenanted facility and knowing what the tenants.
I would tend to disagree. We've seen here in town other centers similar to this, all of having provided a loading zone. You know, I'm concerned that you're going to have trucks stopping behind the building in a two-way drive aisle that I agree is 30 feet, but that's generally what our fire bureau asks for. So it's not like you have a lot of wiggle room there. And what if a truck comes in from one direction and a truck comes in from another direction and now a car shows up? I just think that we don't have enough information to be able to present to the board, you know, that we feel that the way that it's designed is safe.
All right, and that's fine. I certainly understand your planner and your engineer's concerns. So there is a 30-foot drywall behind there, then what we would propose to do would be to make it one-way, one direction. We would have an 18-foot wide aisle that would pass through, and then we'd have a 12-foot wide loading zone across the entire back of the building. It's not that we didn't think about how we're going to load the building. We're going to load the building from the rear. I just prefer to leave it a bit open for the tenants to figure out, because there really isn't supposed to be traffic back there. It's meant for employees and loading only. But if the board feels strongly about making it specific, that would be my proposal to give you a specific loading zone for the rear. As far as the pads go, I mean, obviously, we're not going to be loading out on Route 9. We have plenty of room around these pad sites to provide for loading. My testimony earlier was, for example, I just finished doing a White Castle in Middletown. White Castle has very, very specific needs for how they load and unload. They load at certain times. They do it in a certain way, and they have it very specific for their facilities. Every one of these companies acts the same way. So I think what Mr. Wooters was trying to say was what we would really would like is a preliminary and final approval for the shopping center so that we could go and build the main building, a preliminary approval for the pad site so we could market them, and then having to come back to this board for a final approval for the pads so we could make more definitive answers as far as loading and operation.
So why do you need final for the main building to help you market it, but you don't need final for the pads to help you market those? What's the difference in your marketing strategy there?
Well, the difference really comes down to construction. We'd like to go and build the big building. That's what we would really like to get started doing while we're marketing the pads.
You know, marketing pads for fast food facilities is a little different than marketing a structure that's going to be broken up into basically 15 units that are all relatively the same. Pad can be very different depending on which restaurant is using it. So but that's at least a theory. So.
I have a couple of comments. I see there's perpendicular parking on the pad sites, perpendicular to the building. I don't think I've seen any mention of bollards to protect the vehicle from going into the restaurants.
That's a good point, Mr. Schneider, and your engineer also brought that to our attention, and we have agreed that we will provide bollards for any perpendicular parking to the buildings.
Okay. And also, I'm concerned, but I'm not sure. Also, perpendicular parking facing Highway 9, what protection do you have for all those parking spaces, somebody accelerating right into the highway traffic?
In that case, Mr. Chairman, I'm less bothered by that because of the distance that we have from one to the other.
What is the distance?
Yeah, so I was going to say, give me one second. Let me get a scale drawing out. The distance between the curb on Route 9 and the curb on our parking lot is at its closest point at the southern point of the site. And just looking at the closest distance, that it's about 50 feet. So, I mean, I think that's certainly a big enough safety island for people to react to mistakenly pushing a gas pedal as opposed to a brake pedal. And also, I think it's important to note that we're going to have landscaping and other things like that in there. I mean, could we do something else? Could we put up a wooden guide rail or something along those lines? We could, but it's...
I would suggest that you put up something like a concrete planter that would prevent the car from going on into the highway. 50 feet is still not... if somebody has a medical emergency, 50 feet is not that much, and plowing right into Highway 9 during a major traffic is could be catastrophic. So if you want to put, instead of ballards in front of every parking space, you're going to put concrete planters along that of some sort.
Well, we would agree, Mr. Chairman, to work with your engineer to come up with some kind of system that we believe would adequately allow for vehicular restraint in the event of an emergency like that, while still allowing the center to be aesthetically pleasing. I mean, this is our Route 9 frontage. We want it to look nice when we get finished.
Well, that's fine. Laura?
Mr.
Share that, please.
Yes.
Thank you.
Chairman, Mr. Stevens, normally shopping centers have two points of access, and you know, I understand that you have a limited amount of frontage on Route 9, and it is subject to New Jersey DOT approval, but can you put some testimony on as to why you feel one point of ingress and egress is adequate for this?
Absolutely, Mr. Nash, and a very good question. Our original designs, our original plans did have that, had two one-way driveways coming in and out of the facility. The DOT has asked us to make it a single point of access. We do have our traffic expert with us this evening. We could allow him to do more testimony in that regard, but it was done at a request of DOT.
So this has received DOT access permit?
We don't have a permit yet, but we've been through, I believe, two reviews with them already.
Thank you.
Mr. Stevens, there's going to be a mountable concrete island, right? I think I saw that on page 3.
Yes, that is correct. It's okay. Right in, right out, only for the driveway, obviously, because of the highway here.
Right, okay.
Mr. Stevens, so from what I'm understanding, your original professional opinion was that double access would be better. And we understand that you're under DOT jurisdiction. However, but is it still your testimony saying that the two is better than the one? And you know where I'm going.
Well, I certainly, as the designer, Ms. Nicastro, would have preferred that, but the DOT will not permit it because of the jug handle that goes off into Strickland Road. But again, this is better testimony for our traffic professional than for myself.
Then I'll reserve my questions from then. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Stevens, your site plan, did you use the auto turn to run the trucks running through the parking lot and accessing the rear of the building to load and unload?
Yes, Mr. Nash, we did, and we believe that it meets the requirements and can be adequately and safely done.
What size vehicle it can accommodate?
We looked at a wheelbase 50 vehicle, which in our opinion is the largest vehicles that should be accessing these sites to load them.
Okay, thank you.
Through the chair, I was looking at the parking. You discussed that employee parking was on the rear of the building.
I said there's some, yes.
So that's 16 spots. If you have 15 buildings, 15 different companies here, plus two restaurants, do you think that's adequate parking for staff?
It's not meant to be all of the employee parking, ma'am. My point was that we have some stalls located behind the building that are well-suited to employee parking. The site as a whole meets your shopping center ordinance for parking, but again, our traffic expert will give that parking testimony as we move further through our presentation.
So, but I think that's part of the problem that I'm personally having is that we don't know what this is going to be, and we don't know that some of these 15 units might not be combined for a bigger single tenant. That could be a significant size retail facility that would have more employees that would need to have that parking. I'm a little surprised that there's only that limited parking that's in the back. It looks like you probably had a little bit more room to extend that a little bit further without going into the riparian buffer line. What if those, are those parking spaces absolutely necessary for what you are planning for the tenants that you are looking to desire to obtain for this?
There's a lot of questions in that statement, Mr. Gatto.
Pick anyone you'd like.
The point of a shopping center ordinance and having 5.5 parking spaces per 1,000 square feet is just that you will have some small intense uses, and you'll have larger uses that aren't so intense. I mean, you could put a at-home recreation store in here that could take up five of these units, it could need five parking stalls. Some of these places have bigger sales floor areas and less demand, depending upon the products that they're selling. But again, Mr. Kennel will give us better testimony on that. That's his expertise. But that's the idea behind a shopping center ordinance. And in my experience...
Well, Mr. Stevens, if I can just interrupt you, this is not a shopping center. This is a retail center, which goes back to my original question, which is, was the parking calculated per our ordinance for retail and restaurant? Because that's how it should be calculated. That's how other centers similar in nature are calculated. When we say shopping center, we're talking about Walmart, Lowe's, BJ's. Those are major shopping centers. This would not be considered a shopping center in Howell, which is why the comment was in the letter, which is why we discussed it at the professionals meeting. And that's why I asked the question earlier.
Mr. Chair, I think they've indicated that all these issues are going to be addressed by the traffic engineer. So I think we're probably at the juncture either, you know, we move on to something else for engineering, or if he's done, or if we want to resolve traffic now, you know, bring the traffic up. But how much more do you have on non-traffic or parking issues?
Well, we were going to be going through most of the issues raised by CME in their letter. So,
yeah, so I think, Mr. Chair, I think we should move on to that, and then, you know, we can address all these issues with the traffic engineer.
Let's move on to that.
Okay. So... Mr. Stevens, getting back to the issues raised by CME in their last letter of December 5th, as far as the use of the retail center, the understanding is this would be typical retail tenants with normal hours of operation?
That is my understanding, yes.
Okay. in the event that... there are requirements by the lessees of the pad sites for cross easements, utility agreements. I'm specifically addressing item D, 9D.
I have a question about that, Mr. Waters. You're not subdividing the lot, so
no.
Why would they need cross easements if they're on the same lot? Isn't there one owner of the lot?
There is one owner of the lot.
I mean, there may be internal lease issues that they'll have to resolve with each other, but there'll be there's no one to give an easement to.
That's correct, but okay. I'm specifically addressing the language contained in CME's letter, and they raised the issue about cross easements and drainage issues, and so I'm just reinforcing the fact that whatever is required in between the tenants of the property consists of two lots, and most likely, as part of this process, we'll consolidate it into one lot. So, you know, it will be, I would think, part of the process. But yeah.
So actually, why don't we just get that off the table now? Is it going to be consolidated or?
Well, consolidated, yeah.
Okay.
Mr. Stevens, there was an issue or a question with regard to mounted signs and whether the signs would be built in accordance with the applicable standards and codes of Howell Township?
It is the applicant's intention to construct signs for the subject facility that will comply with your ordinance. If we were to look at the architectural plan, which we've submitted as part of our exhibits, we will see that there are facade-mounted signs for each of the proposed tenants, as well as one sign, a pylon sign, which would be located out on Route 9. Your engineer asked a question regarding the height of the pylon sign, which I believe your ordinance had permitted at 50 feet, which is not correct. Your ordinance only allows signs to be up to 45 feet based upon my most recent reading. So we would propose to change our requirement to lower that sign by 5 feet. And then the sign area of the pylon sign will also comply.
Thank you, Mr. Stevens. Would you comment and explain to the board generally the stormwater management measures that are proposed for the site and how they comply with applicable NJDEP standards?
I'd be happy to. As I stated earlier in my testimony, we're proposing to construct a detention basin which will be located along the southern border of the development adjacent to the Manasquan River. Stormwater will be collected from the proposed buildings in the parking area, conveyed through an underground piping system, into the stormwater management system, where certain lower water quality storms will be held and retained back into the earth, and then overflow from that will be discharged on a very, very limited basis into the Manasquan River. The system as designed currently complies with the New Jersey State Stormwater Regulations, as well as your ordinance, and we have also received soil erosion approval from Freehold Soils, who again looks very thoroughly at the stormwater management systems for these. So I think that's also important to note.
Mr. Stevens, is this going to be a wet basin?
No, it is not.
Okay, thank you.
And in conjunction with that, would you comment, please, on compliance with stream preservation regulations as per the ordinance 188-34?
Yes, there. One of the things that we were asked to do by your professionals was to go back and get a determination from the state of New Jersey regarding the flood hazard area adjacent to this site. As I said in my testimony, the Manasquan River is adjacent to the site, as well as a tributary that runs along the eastern boundary of the site. And we went and did that. We did get a flood hazard area determination from the state of New Jersey, showing the riparian buffers that are shown on our plans. We have a riparian buffer of 150 feet. To both the tributary as well as the Manasquan River and those stream corridors, that riparian buffer we're proposing to remain undisturbed.
Do you have a board that shows the riparian area that if not, that's fine.
Yeah, we do. Ms. Newman just put up on the board the site plan that's been submitted as part of our application. And you can see the riparian buffer located behind the buildings where she's showing you now, adjacent to the tributary to the Manasquan River. And as we go further down and to the left or to the west now, we'll see the riparian buffer to the Manasquan River itself. And again, that 150 feet is proposed to remain undisturbed.
Now, there will be a pump station located on the property, is that correct?
That is correct, yes.
Can you explain the operation of the proposed pump station?
Water and sewer for the facility will be provided through municipal services. This is New Jersey American Water Company's territory. We are proposing to build a pump station at the rear of the main retail building, which will be privately owned by the applicant. That pump station will pump back up to the sewer located on Route 9, as well as provide, we're going to bring water in from Route 9 to the subject site. So we'll have both municipal water and municipal sewer through New Jersey American Water Company.
I think this would be a good point to go over some of the architecturals.
Sure.
I'm sorry, Mr. Woodis. Can you go over a little bit more about this pumping station, the details, failure? Well, that's, you know, we're in a very environmentally sensitive area, so I'm just curious how this whole sewer thing is going to work.
What we would propose to do is to construct a pump station, as I said, in the rear of the subject site. It will be constructed below ground. It will be a vault system. There'll be duplicate pumps in the facility itself, so in the event that one fails or needs to be maintained, you can remove one and also still have the station up in operation. I wouldn't expect any failure rates from these. The station itself has to be maintained by someone who's licensed in the state of New Jersey to provide such maintenance. And there's a lot of oversight to these things. I mean, typically they don't have failure rates. I mean, all across Howell Township, you'll see stations like this located along the streams because naturally that's where the low points of our land are, where the streams go. You'll find the main sewers follow the streams. And in this case, you'll see that Monmouth County Regional has an interceptor that runs along the Manasquan right below our site.
And these have generator backup and all that?
Correct, okay. Yes.
I have a question about some of the flood and stormwater management issues. I thought you were going to take a break there before you went on to the pump station. So if you would allow me just to go back a little bit.
Absolutely.
It took me a while to piece it all together, but it's pretty obvious now to me that there's no feature of the stormwater retention system that's either within the riparian buffer or within the flood hazard boundary. That's correct, right?
That is correct, Mr. Gunn.
Was the information and that determination by the DEP and the LOI that you received and all of those outside approvals and reviews, was it done based on historical recent data?
The answer to the question is yes. One of the issues that your professionals also asked, we had a valid LOI on this site that was scheduled to expire through the Permit Extension Act this summer on June the 30th. So we actually went back to the DEP and got an extension for that LOI, even though we technically didn't need it, to show that it is current and they are looking at things from a current standpoint. And it's...
That LOI was dated, I think, 2007. And so...
So a lot has happened since 2007, particularly with this property.
That's correct. And that's the reason why we went back to the DEP and had them relook at the entire LOI. Instead of relying on the Permit Extension Act, said just give us a new one. And they did reanalyzed the property in its entirety.
So they reanalyzed it based on recent storm activity and specific to what happened on this site? I guess I'm having a little bit of trouble.
They have submitted as part of their application documentation the updated LOI, which was dated January 27, 2016. And it basically says, please be advised, after review of the most recent updated resource value information and site conditions, the division hereby extends the original LOI without modification to July 24th, 2017, 5 years from the original LOI.
So in layman's terms, help me out here.
So they basically revisited the site. They took more current information with respect to any threatened endangered species.
As it existed today.
Correct. Well, in January of last year.
Okay. But I think this site has some adverse history to flooding.
Right. So they would have reviewed it. And I want to note that the flood hazard permit with the riparian buffer, which really goes along with the stream, that was dated February of 2016. So they're very current.
So again, in layman's terms, help me out with how this site could have flooded after Irene and the storm that we received several months after that.
Well, wetlands is not necessarily a factor of flooding. I mean, hydrology is one of the factors, but there's a vegetation component as well as a soils component. So when you're looking at wetlands, it's not necessarily in an anomaly event like an Irene, where you have a tremendous amount of rainfall, because even Sandy wasn't that high rain, it was more wind and coastal flooding. But in a circumstance like Irene, just because water flooded onto the property at one point doesn't necessarily make that area wet.
So the line that's shown for the flood hazard line, that's based on statistical and pure...
They would have filed, and there should be copies here because it's a requirement. There's probably a copy in the planning board office because there's a requirement as part of the notice for a DEP permit that the township receive copies of all applications, and part of the application package would have been their drainage report, the soils information, you know, plans, et cetera. And so the DEP in their engineering department at the land use division would go through that and would review all of that information prior to the issuance of a permit.
So then essentially that line that's labeled as a flood hazard line, the assumption on my part is that's similar to a 100-year flood hazard boundary line, correct?
Yes. And then they've identified that this site is requires a 150-foot riparian buffer, and that's measured from the top of bank, correct, Mr. Stevens?
That is correct, yes.
So, you know, in many cases where it's a flatter circumstance and you have a water body, they measure it from the center line of the stream. Okay. But here, because there's defined bank, they measure that line from the top of bank, which is more restrictive as it extends farther into the developable portion of the site.
Okay.
So that's what they've done. So they've identified the flood hazard line based on information, their application that was submitted. I would assume the application was submitted, what, last winter to get your determination? Yes. Mm-hmm. In February, and then, you know, they would have evaluated all of that information prior to the issuance of the permit.
So then my simple question is, if this site and this property flooded previously, and it was known not to be a 100-year storm event, and it happened twice within 6 months, why is that still shown as the, how is this?
I mean, this is really outside of our jurisdiction. This is a DEP issue. And the DEP have their regulatory requirements under the flood hazard area rules, which have gone around and around, public comment, been vetted, and then ultimately adopted. So they have their regulations and their rules. They evaluate that based upon, you know, the current, I think our drainage requirements mimic the DEP's drainage requirements. So they go through the reports that were provided, which includes soil logs and information with respect to the conditions on the property and all of their calculations with their drainage system and the flood area, and then they make their determination. So I don't think that it's based on, okay, well, this site had two major rain events in this area over the course of a year, therefore water was sitting on the property. You know, I think it would take more than that for that situation to change. But at the same time,
If there's a new project or a new application, isn't there an expectation that that should have been done?
Well, they went and got their permit. That's basically all we can ask them to do. We cannot require them to do something beyond the DEP because this is a DEP jurisdiction.
So can we ask testimony as to what this application or this project does to better or worsen the conditions
Absolutely.
That we've experienced in the past?
Absolutely, you can do that.
Well, I guess that's my question. So, you know, we've served some time in this town and we saw what this area looked like on two storms that I don't believe were 100-year storms. And I'm very interested to know what the impact of this project will be to either make that better or worse.
Fully understood, Mr. Gatto. So this project should have absolutely no effect on that. There should be no change one way or another because we're not disturbing anything within the riparian buffer. So there's 150 feet from that stream, which we're not touching. And in this case, if you're familiar with this piece of property, there's a very, I'm from Ocean County, so I would say steep topographic difference between where we're building the job and where the river itself is. This stream encroachment line that you see on my drawings is a FEMA-approved study. So they set this line at elevation 70. Then what we do to establish this line is we add a foot to that. So this line is set at elevation 71. So it's a foot above what FEMA says we should expect to see here for a 100-year storm. And then from there, because we have this riparian buffer that has nothing to do with flood, it has to do with other environmental issues, there's basically another 12 feet between that elevation and our project. So there is way beyond ample room for any kind of conservatism you'd want to think about as far as engineering goes and flood studies here.
If I could, though, then the flip. So you spoke about that. Maybe you could take the board through the development side of this and then specifically your discharge, because your discharge is a point source which ultimately goes in the direction of the waterway. So can you address that with the board as well?
Yeah, I would be happy to, Ms. Newman. So what we've done is we've gone through to take beyond ample care for what would be necessary for stormwater discharge from this site as well. And as I said, we already have received approval from Soils, who went through this in very great detail. We are showing under a pre-development calculation that the downstream point of the Manasquan River, we'd have about 12 CFS of flow. We're discharging, hold on, let me make sure I got this right. Less than one CFS back to the site. So in other words, we're going to be discharging significantly less water than what's going there now under a pre-development. And that's on purpose.
And why is that? How is that accomplished?
So it's accomplished by designing a detention basin, which is designed to store and hold water and release it at much lower rates. That's the way that the system functions.
And there's no, as you indicated, you have a freehold soils permit, but there's no volume issue associated with that point source either, correct?
That is correct, yes.
And what's the maximum depth of the detention basin from top of berm to the bottom of it? Plus minus.
Our top of berm is 81.5. The bottom of the basin is at 75 plus or minus. So it's about 6.5 feet, something like that. So we've gone out of our way to be very conservative with our drainage design, Mr. Gatto. I mean, from a township standpoint, from a state standpoint, we meet the requirements and well beyond them. And that was done on purpose because of the environmental sensitivity of the project. From a flood standpoint, we're really changing nothing because we're not changing anything in the flood corridor itself. And beyond that, as I said, there's more than 10 feet of vertical elevation beyond the storage that will be allowed and left to function as potential overflow flood. So from an engineering standpoint, I'm not sure that there's more we really could do to satisfy this.
So Laura, not to put you on the spot here, but do you agree that a site improvement with a retention basin on a site that previously flooded would be a likely advantageous tool to prevent such an occurrence in the future? Again, not going through all the specifics, but is that even possible that could happen? Just having a hard time piecing it together. We know what happened here before, and I'm not hearing definitive saying that it's not going to happen again based on the conditions that we knew in the past.
Well, I think you never say never, but what I would tell you is the difference between the vertical change as well as horizontal change, there's a lot of room for storage even in the event that the river were to overflow.
Okay.
So there's a lot of area for that to be contained. So I'm comfortable that that's contained, and then I'm comfortable that they've designed their drainage in such a way so that it doesn't add. That would be more of my concern because we're discharging on one end on the same aspect that we have a flowing river. So if you understand, my concern is the two things peaking.
Right.
But I am comfortable that it is designed, one, from a site condition to make it work and not impact the rate of flow as it's going through the river. And I'm comfortable, given the horizontal and vertical separation, that we have the storage there. I say that we have technical comments as it relates to the drainage. They're very technical in nature. They're contained in the technical report. I assume that Mr. Stevens agrees to comply with all those.
We do, Ms. Lee.
It's not common that we talk about a basin in terms of storage, right? We talk about it in terms of retention and outfall and, you know, how much time that water sits in that basin. And in this particular case, we're talking about that basin functioning as a storage facility if the adjacent Manasquan River happens to be inundated during the same event. Is that fair to say?
I don't think you see that, because what I will tell you is this is designed, when you're looking at flood hazard, there are excess storms. So we're talking about beyond 100-year storm events. So I don't think we hit a situation where we have the flood elevation of the river and that back surging into this basin. No, I don't think that occurs. I mean, the water in the basin is going to be held back, no different than any other basin we've seen. It's retained so that we can achieve quality and quantity, so that it's not released at such a rate that it's detrimental to downstream. So I don't think you have a situation. I think what you're saying is that you're concerned that the water from the river could overflow and backcharge this basin.
Well, that is what happened, right? So
it actually, the flooding came from the other side.
Came from the other side.
It flooded.
Right.
So, all of Route 9.
So, I probably should make this a little clearer. So, this area was a major area of concern for the township following two significant storms, mm-hmm. to the point where we actually infused Blue Acres funding, I guess it's called, to actually buy out homes in an area that was not identified as being within a flood zone, based on some of the very same criteria that I suspect might have been done for this property for your project. So I'm a little hesitant to just unilaterally accept the testimony of what could happen here during a similar situation, knowing what's happened in the past and not knowing for sure if any of these changes to any of these flood hazard boundary lines or where these buffers should be did not change reflective of those issues, because in all fairness, the DEP didn't do a really good job in this area of town the first time, and I'm not sure I'm willing to trust them a second time.
Well, let me ask you a question, Mr. Gatto, because perhaps I don't understand that. Are those homes that you're talking about that flooded, are they on the west side of Route 9?
That's
the ones
correct.
On Burgerville Road?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
That's
I know exactly. So that flooding is actually caused by the culvert of Route 9. We're downstream of that. So that issue doesn't exist on the other side of Route 9. It's the culvert itself that causes back. I mean, this now becomes a very complicated engineering discussion, but those culverts actually cause these rivers to back up, and that's, I'm assuming, what happened with the cases of those homes on Burgerville. And if you look at the current DEP flood maps, of which this is part of my approval comes from what the DEP has done and has issued in 2009, they do show those homes being in the flood zone.
I wouldn't disagree with you if I wasn't standing there that day and saw the Manasquan flowing from east to west.
I'm not sure. I don't understand your
it didn't work the way you're describing that day.
But did it overtop Route 9?
Yes.
It did?
Yes.
Okay, so that...
Significantly.
That I'm not aware of.
And on this property. That's why I'm asking these questions.
Well, that I couldn't explain. The flood study that the DEP approved was done in 2009. That's their latest study.
That's exactly the concern that I have. We don't have any authority to get that requested based on... I believe there's even a DEP metering station here.
I don't think, I mean, I would defer to Ron, but I don't think that we have the authority to supersede the DEP.
I don't think we have the authority to supersede the DEP, but I think perhaps some of this goes into a larger question for the board as to when we grant preliminary and final versus when we maybe just grant preliminary, if we're going to grant anything at all. And I think, you know, a lot of times the board has granted preliminary and final, and we've left some conditions and issues to be resolved later. I think, you know, we may want to shift ourselves back to having a more complete application before we grant a final and look at, you know, not granting preliminary and final so often at the same time. I don't think that the board can supersede or overrule the DEP. I did, however, Laura and I had an extensive conversation this afternoon with the environmental expert from CME to talk about just this, and also some issues that are probably going to be raised later regarding endangered species as to what does a town do? What's your recourse if you don't think that the proper data was analyzed by a state agency? And Laura and I spoke to Jill Giddings at her office, and you know, it was his opinion that the town does have some ability to, if it so chose, and I'm not saying the planning board, I'm saying the governing body has some ability, if it so chose, to hire its own qualified professional to, you know, observe and submit data to the DEP in an effort to have them reconsider. I'm not saying that that's going to be a successful endeavor. I mean, I'm quite certain it would take an effort to make them undo an approval or something that they've already done. But Mr. Giddings advised that's something that is available to the township governing body if it's so wanted and could be done, you know, for instance, between a preliminary and a final.
So are you saying, what I'm thinking I'm hearing is that we would, if so choose, to grant preliminary, as two members of the governing body sit on this board, we could go back to the full board and discuss having our own professionals look at this property and address specific questions we have as a governing body? And
I think if you want to, yes, generally, and that's what Mr. Giddings has advised the DEP would entertain, although I still think that although they may entertain it, it may not be a warm welcome for them, you know, for the town to say you got it wrong or you didn't analyze the proper data. But it's an opportunity to present data that may persuade the DEP to reconsider, you know, a previous position.
Okay.
But again, that's, you know, not a planning board. Planning board is not going to send someone out. That thing that has to be the governing body who makes that decision.
Well, Council, can we make, I guess, preliminary approval contingent on an additional study granted by the governing body?
Well, I wouldn't. First of all, we're not at the position where we even know we're going to grant a preliminary approval.
If we
grant a preliminary approval. I wouldn't condition it on that because we don't know what the governing body is going to do. I think it would be something more broad that the governing body could elect to do it if it so chose. If you make it so that the governing body has to do it, then the applicant, you know, it's a condition the applicant may never be able to satisfy, and that's not fair to the applicant. So I think that it would just be something if the governing body elected to do that, they could do that. But again, I want to be very clear that, you know, once a state agency has made a decision, you know, it's not unlike a court when you go for reconsideration. You know, they decided something the first time around. I think it's an uphill battle to get them to decide something differently. But, you know, again, Laura, you can tell me if I'm wrong or not, that was the upshot of what Mr. Giddings advised could be done.
No, that is correct, but as Ron had indicated too, it's not an easy challenge. However, it is available.
So the process would be is the governing body would have to, since they're a participant in the community flood hazard program, they would have to petition the DEP, whether the town funds it or not, to basically redraw the flood boundary.
Well, I think there may be any number of avenues, you know, that the town may elect to pursue. That may be one of them. You know, I'm not prepared to say exactly how it is, you know, structurally that it would work, but, you know, conceptually it's available. But it's going to have to be done by a professional, you know, who has a qualification in that field.
So for the purpose of this applicant and this testimony, is it fair to say that nothing that we are talking about now has been done based on the dates that they used in their testimony? None of that's been contemplated.
Well, I think maybe the applicant, you know, can address that.
You know, the applicant is as concerned as you are with situations like flooding and drainage. I mean, the applicant does not want to have his property flooded. And so that's why the applicant willingly went back to the DEP to have them relook at the LOI, to restudy the property, and to basically reapprove it. Unfortunately, we are a creature of state regulations. So the applicant's position is we're very understanding. We share the concern of the township. We want to be a good property owner, and we don't want to have floods either. But all we can do is have your very competent engineers review our proposals in conjunction with the required state approvals. We've acquired those. So if the township wants to do something, and I agree with Mr. Cuchero that it's a slippery slope, you're going to have to go back and basically question the state criteria for their approval, which if you want to do, that's fine. But, you know, there's nothing we can do at this point in time.
Well, I don't even know. That may be true, but it may be that the data that was provided, you know, somehow wasn't entirely up to date. So it may be what you're talking about, but it could also be if the town, you know, determines that the data that was put through the formula was incorrect. You wouldn't have to change the formula. It's just, you know, it's a different set of data that you may have to use. But
right. Just getting the state to accept different information, you know, that they accepted previously.
Yes.
Good luck with that. But yeah. But we're more than willing to cooperate in that mm-hmm. effort. It's nothing we can do. I mean, we've gone to the state. They've analyzed it. They've approved it. So.
I'm fine with that. I appreciate your comments, and there was no criticism on your part at all.
Oh, I understand that, Mr. Scott. You know, it's difficult working with the state at best at any given time. And, so any other discussions on the basin stormwater management at this point? Because I want to go back a little bit to some basic description of the project. Mr. Stevens, if you would just briefly describe the surrounding areas, you know, what is immediately surrounding the project?
I'd be happy to. The subject property is bounded to the north by the Villages Project, to the east partially by the Villages Project, partially by this tributary to the Manasquan River that we've been talking about. To the south, the property is bordered by the Manasquan River and some other commercial development located along Route 9. And then to the west is Route 9 itself and some commercial development located across the street from the subject property.
And the commercial property on Route 9, is that also located within the HD Highway Development Zone?
It is, yes.
The same zone that the project is located within?
Correct, yes.
With regard to zoning compliance, without going through each of the items, I made a statement previously in my introduction that the property was, is a permitted use and in compliance with the zoning ordinance. Is that accurate?
That is correct, yes.
Okay. However, the applicant has required a couple of variances.
Right, so you're just saying the use is permitted?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
So if we could review what we're seeking a waiver for.
So that there is one item in your professional's review, item 4A, on page 3 of the review that talks about a required variance for the subject property. We're talking about the very northern part of the project, the very northwestern part of the project, the developed area that borders against the villages. We're required to provide a buffer there that is required to be 50 feet in width, the four-season buffer. The applicant is proposing to leave 50 feet of vegetation along that particular area that we're talking about, and to provide supplemental planting in there to do some other work. We have met with your tree expert, we have reviewed this, and I think we've come to consensus that this is the best plan. We are proposing to build a 10-foot fence as required by your ordinance along the back of the village's property. So in our interpretation, we meet the intent of your ordinance, but technically there is still a variance required. In order for the applicant to remove this variance from this application, we would have to cut all the trees down in that 50-foot buffer. And there are some nice trees there. I mean, I don't personally believe that's the right answer, but if that's how the board wants to look at this application, it is certainly something that we could do. We could clear the trees, build a berm, and plant the buffer plantings that would be necessary, but I believe that our plan is a superior one to that.
And you meet the 100-foot setback for the parking area?
No, we do not. So what that ordinance basically says, you have to have two things. You have to have, and it lists four or five things. I don't have it in front of me, but it talks about having a 10-foot high fence, about having a landscape berm, or being, I believe it's 200 feet to a building and 100 feet to a parking lot, something like that. So you have to have two of those items out of whatever that is, four or five criteria. So what we're proposing to do is to build the fence along the property line to give us one of those, and then to provide the landscaping would be our second point to meeting your buffer requirement. Technically, your requirement is that we would have to build a berm there. So in order for us to do that, we'd have to clear the existing trees, which, again, in my opinion, I don't think is the right answer. But if that's what the board would like us to do, we certainly could do that and present it.
I'd just like to hear from our certified tree expert, and that would clear it up for me.
Mm-hmm. I went out on the site, and there are actually decent trees on site. A lot of black walnut exists over there, which we don't always see. I was actually kind of surprised they're over there. You don't see them from Route 9. A lot of them aren't incredibly large, so I feel like if we kept them, we have a lot of years that we'd get from them. They are trees that are allelopathic, which means certain trees can't grow next to them. So I did give Bill a list of species that would do okay next to those trees. So he worked with me, and you know, I gave him a list of different species to use, and they have them in there. There's notes to field locate them. To me, it looks like a pretty nice buffer. I'd like to see the trees kept.
Okay. So in your opinion, that existing buffer with the supplemental plantings that you've offered would provide an effective buffer between this retail establishment and the villages?
Right. Yeah, I think it would provide a good buffer. They have a mix of evergreens as well as deciduous trees in there, and then along with the fence, you know, that would block out, you know, whatever won't be filled in from the, you know, planting the trees, because, you know, we're not going to get a buffer. There'll be holes in it. There's not going to be a wall-to-wall buffer because you're going to have to work around the existing trees. But with the fence, I think it should provide a decent screen for them, for sure.
Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Stevens, the applicant is also seeking two design waivers, and if you could discuss those.
That is correct. Also listed on the same page of the CME letter, page 3. This is item 5 now. Item A, section 188-106G. your ordinance requires that areas between the proposed buildings and the parking areas be landscaped. In this particular issue, along the front of the big building, we would propose or would prefer to have a paved walkway in front of the building. It just makes the building function better, in my opinion, than trying to put landscape islands in there. We could if we were forced to, but I don't think they would be practical. I don't think it would work well. If you do look at the landscape plan that we prepared, we have proposed a substantial amount of landscaping. We have worked with your tree expert to try to come up with a plan that we think is going to be very aesthetically pleasing. So we would prefer to have this waiver granted. One of the things that we could do, and that the architect drew onto his plans, was to provide some planters out in front of these buildings that could potentially be used to provide some seasonal plantings, flowers, shrubs, that kind of stuff, to enhance the beauty of the building. But for me as an engineer, the site would work better with a walkway in front of the building rather than trying to put in a small landscape strip in front of the building.
How wide is that walkway in front of the building?
It's approximately 14 feet to the face of the curb, something like that. But we have columns and there's an overhang. It just, to me, it functions better without trying to put in small broken landscaping strips. But again, if that's the board's prerogative, it could be done. I'd like to think that the plan, the way we have it designed, is a good plan. I think our landscaping plan, once completed, will be something we'll all be proud of, but that's my opinion.
Would the elevations help?
Mr. Stevens, did you provide an alternate, a plan that we can see with the, that complies with our ordinance? Can you show the board how it would look, I guess? Because, I mean, you said it just doesn't flow. You said the flow would be off, and you said it wouldn't work.
Right. Well, what we would do, Mr. Russo, is we would take a strip along that curb line 2 or 3 feet in width and provide some landscaping in there. It just, to me, it's not exactly practical. Kind of areas become hard to maintain. They collect trash. And then, you know, in today's environment, we're trying to provide for good pedestrian access to and from the site. That me as an engineer, that's my paramount concern. I want to get people safely in and out of the buildings, and I just see things like that as a tripping hazard. People are going to walk over them. I would prefer, if the board is really concerned about having landscaping in front of the building, that we did it with planters. That would be my preference.
But you don't have anything that pictorially represents the proposal at this point. I think that was one of the questions that... Can they visualize that?
We're asking for the waiver, Mr. Russo. That's what we're seeking. That's what our plans show. The architect does show some planters on his elevation, the rendering that he prepared. Could certainly be enhanced. There could certainly be more.
Right.
You know, if that's something the board would like to see. I don't know.
Have you seen the Cole Shopping Center? They have beautiful landscaping along their sidewalks. That makes the entire shopping center. You walk along their sidewalk, it's just beautiful. Does everybody concur?
I think it's beautiful.
Ornamental trees and shrubs. It's a credit to the community to have something like that.
Yeah, so, but I believe a lot of their landscaping is up against the building.
Pardon?
Their landscaping along the strip is up against the building.
Yes.
And I believe he's talking about the buffer along the curb line, correct?
Right. Well, in this case, what we're trying to do is a small community shopping center. I mean, you want your storefronts, you need door entries. You know, they're small stores. This isn't a giant big box center. So to place landscaping along the building itself, I would think would be a difficult thing to do here. It would probably lend itself better along the curb where, again, it becomes, in my opinion, a difficult thing to maintain and not perhaps the most safest way to move people in and out of a center.
Because it limits exactly where they can enter it onto the property.
Correct. But Mr. Chairman, I think it's important to note, though, that we have gone through and prepared an extensive landscaping plan. It's not like we're trying to skimp on landscaping. It's just this one particular quirk in your ordinance, I think, doesn't fit well to this design that we're looking at. That's my only point.
Okay.
Okay, move on, I'll move on, and...
Well, I think before we should move on, I think we should take a 10-minute break. It's 9 o'clock.
Okay.
So, take a 10-minute break.
Thank you.
May I? Okay. My witness is still out of the room, so if I could, I have to apologize. I did get ahead of myself somewhat in starting the testimony. I need to enter into evidence as an exhibit, an aerial map, which I've provided copies of to Eileen.
Some exhibits have been pre-marked, so we're starting with A19 tonight.
Okay. So this would be the... Ron, do you have the packet in front of you?
I have.
Okay. So first is an aerial map.
So we'll just mark this as a single exhibit.
Okay.
A19. And how many pages is it?
Well, it consists of the aerial map, 5 pages of the site plan, another aerial map, some architectural frontal elevations, and a rendering.
5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
So you're going to...
Did I count correct? 12 pages, is that correct?
Yeah, so it would be just A1 through 12?
Yeah, it'll be A19.
A19.
Which is a 12-page packet. Okay. We'll call it a 12-page aerial plan packet.
This is A19.
The whole package.
The whole package.
Okay, that's fine.
All right. Thank you. Mr. Stevens, you would please discuss, there is a second waiver, design waiver, that the applicant is requesting specifically from Section 188-195C with regard to planting trees. Would you please describe for the board the nature of that design waiver request?
That is also correct. Also listed on page 3 of the CME report, and I'm now talking about item 5B, section 188-195C. The applicant is seeking a waiver in lieu of planting trees, replacement trees on site. We wish to make a contribution for a portion of the trees, which we believe we don't have the room to replace on site. So we're seeking that waiver.
Questions with regard to that request or any further explanation?
No.
Are you okay?
Good.
Okay.
I think, Mr. Wooters, that pretty much sums up my engineering testimony. Save for any further questions from the board or the public,
Mr. Wooters?
Yes.
I have some questions. Based upon some, I think, inquiries or submissions that have been made by the public over time. And I think if you get out ahead of it, you know, it may help to
Fine.
Frame some of the questions when the public session gets open.
All right.
One is when you look at the GIS mapping that the DEP has for this area, it indicates that this is a habitat for endangered species. And I think there are two in particular that there were even some sightings in the area, one being bobcat and the other being the bald eagle. Now, I understand that you have the LOI and the LOI was renewed. If your expert can talk to us about what it means to be on the GIS as being a habitat and what it means when you get the LOI, you know, one being something general and one being something very site-specific, and, you know, what your position or what the applicant's position is on the existence or presence of any endangered species.
Well, Mr. Cuchero, to be clear, we haven't done any endangered species studies of the subject site, nor did we feel that any were required for this particular piece of property.
Why did you not believe they were required?
One of the ways that we look at sites like this, and one of the things that we use, are the DEP's own review and determinations for property. In this particular case, we have a letter of interpretation that was issued by the state of New Jersey for the wetlands on site.
Right. Well, if I could back you up for a moment, though, because I think it's important for members of the board and the public to understand, before we get to the LOI, the fact that, you know, the site showed up on the GIS mapping at the DEP as being, you know, a habitat. Can you talk to us briefly about what, how it is that happens and what the significance of it is? And you know, as you're going to be talking about site-specific, talk to us about how that is not site-specific.
Well, generally what the database shows when we talk about endangered species is that they show areas that the state believes has the potential for the occurrence of endangered species.
Okay. So basically they are taking reports of sightings and certain geographic or topographic, you know, features that may lend itself to endangered species and extrapolating that over a broad area there may be endangered species. Would that be fair to say?
That would be correct, Mr. Cucciaro.
Okay, so now fast forward us to the LOI process and how that differs.
So when the state gives you a letter of interpretation for wetlands, they look at the endangered species potential for the area. They actually come out, they walk the site, and they look at the potential for that. There's three different levels of buffers that the DEP would give us for a wetlands. They give you a zero buffer for an ordinary wetland, a 50-foot buffer for, thank you, my brain got stuck, for an intermediate wetland, which is what we have here. And they give you a 150-foot buffer for exceptional wetlands, which would be a wetland that they believed held endangered species. So because the state gave us an intermediate rating for this site, it would be my belief that the state would say that there are non-endangered species on this property. That would be their opinion. Would also be my opinion. I'm an engineer. I'm not an environmental expert, but that would be the way I would come to that answer.
Well, I mean, isn't it more than that? It's not that you believe that that's the DEP's position. I mean, doesn't the DEP look at that specific issue when they are issuing the LOI?
Yes, Mr. Cucciaro, I'm
so
sorry.
It's not anyone's subjective belief. That's part of their analysis. So when they issue the LOI, isn't that an affirmative statement from the DEP that there is not habitat for the presence or habitat for endangered species?
That would be correct. I'm sorry if that was not clear.
Mm-hmm. I would make the same comment, you know, with regard to the governing body, if it feels that's something they would want to pursue. If a preliminary is granted between preliminary and final, that's something that they can pursue. But, you know, I think it's important to understand why there is a belief out there that there is a presence of endangered species, because you go on DEP's website, you look at their mapping, that's what they tell you. So I think it's important to understand that that's not actually a definitive statement that those species or their habitats are located on this particular piece of property. The dispositive statement from the DEP is actually the issuance of the LOI, or the letter of interpretation. But again, if the town feels that somehow, you know, something was missed in that process, then, you know, certainly that's something the town could endeavor to investigate also. The second issue that I think is going to be raised, because it was put forth in some preliminary inquiries, is the environmental status of the site. And, you know, number one, it had been historically used for agricultural uses. So if I don't know, Mr. Waters, if this is the witness for that or someone else, but go through what testing was done on the property, what was tested for, and what the results were.
Of course. Keeping in mind, as the applicant testified when he first gave testimony, he's owned the property since 1985. Since 1985, the property has been basically vacant. I believe prior to that, he thought it was a egg farm. But in any event, Mr. Stevens can testify as to what testing was done, which, frankly, your engineers had noted the fact that, according to aerials, the property appears to have been farmed at one point in time. And so based on that, we were requested to do further studies, and Mr. Stevens will describe that.
Mr. Wooters is correct in what he stated. Your professional staff had asked for us to go out and do a historical pesticides analysis on the subject property because it had evidence of being a prior farm site. So we did just that. We hired the firm of Lewis Consulting Group. They're an environmental firm located in Manasquan. They prepared a site investigation report dated November 16, 2016, which did a historical pesticides analysis in accordance with your ordinance, complies, and the results came back negative. There are no historical pesticides issues on the subject property.
When you say no historical pesticide issues, are there pesticides present, but they're just within acceptable levels?
All the samples that were taken, all the tests that were done, came back at below threshold levels. That's okay. Correct.
So, and I've been learning more about this process in the last few days also. When you do testing like that, is it to test for any kind of contaminant, or is it very specific to certain contaminants that are associated with agricultural operations?
It's very specific. Your ordinance gives specific requirements for that testing, and that is what the Lewis Consulting Group went out and did.
So normally, in a situation where you don't have an owner who's also the developer, if you have an owner who later is going to sell to a developer, there would be a due diligence process, and the developer would come in and likely do a phase one on the property to discover if there were any other, environmental issues associated with the site. Now, this is different. That kind of backstop is not going to be there because it's not being sold to anyone. It's the owner is the developer. So I guess, is it fair to say unknown if there are any other contaminants on the property because it's not something that the ordinance required you to test for?
The answer to that is yes. The ordinance did not require us to test for it. Your professionals, while pointing out the agricultural history of the property, did not require us to test for it. But from an applicant's point of view, and forgetting about the fact that they own the property, and I'm sure when they acquired the property, did that kind of due diligence.
That was going to be my next question, that if that does exist, whether you could provide that to us.
I will ask them. They bought the property in 1985. Mm-hmm. They did not do a phase one. So in 1985, because I think there was no reason to. When you're looking at a piece of property, whether you're a developer or whether you're potentially buying it, you're looking at the property, and was it, is there a reasonable concern that it was used for industrial use or other contaminants? Was there a filling station there at one point in time? And best of my client's knowledge and based on their preliminary and investigations, there was never any reason to investigate the environmental condition of the property beyond the agricultural use because there was never any indication that there was any other environmental issues.
Would, in the event you do get a preliminary approval, would the applicant object to a condition asking for a broader test?
A broader test for what? The applicant is always willing to cooperate, and we understand what the town's concerns, but this is an expensive process.
I would say, it would probably testing to be determined by our environmental expert in conjunction with your engineer. For whatever contaminants that our environmental expert feels would be relevant to the developability of the site. Anything that might require a cap or, extraction or anything like that.
Could we limit it to a phase one? Yeah, can we limit it to a phase one?
Well, if you want to do a phase one, that's fine.
I really don't want to do a phase one, but if we had to,
I don't object to that.
Okay.
At least that's specific.
Yeah, so
that would show areas of concern, so that would.
If the board reasonably believes that it's necessary to make an inquiry about non-existent contaminants, then the applicant will cooperate and...
I don't know that I quite agree with how that statement was framed. Since no one's done any investigation and no one can tell me that they aren't there because I never looked for them.
Right.
To say that because I didn't look for them, they're not there. I don't know that that follows.
I think the applicant's position is there's no reasonable basis to believe that they are there, but if that is a requirement of the board, then fine.
Well, I think we'll leave that to the end of the hearing.
Okay, I mean, it's...
The board can discuss that if and when you get an approval.
But with the applicant would do a phase one if you want it.
Okay.
So,
okay, I think that exhausts what I had sort of received by way of inquiry and issues. That I think you did a good job sort of framing the issue, you know, before the public session.
So does the board have any other further questions of Mr. Stevens? If not, then I'd like to move on to my traffic expert, and if he could then testify.
Yes, go
ahead. Mr. Chair, before we leave Mr. Stevens, can you clarify for me what use you're proposing or the applicant is proposing in that mezzanine area? I know we touched on it early on in the hearing, but is that combined with the tenants underneath, or is it separate office space, or what is being used on that upstairs?
There's no specific plan for that space. The space is available for lease to a tenant for whatever retail or other use is permitted under the ordinance. So it could be a store. Right now, it's there, and it may very well be that you won't have a tenant that would want to rent the space, but it
would
be
separate,
available.
It's separate space from the underneath stores, let's
it
say.
It is. It
okay.
is.
So I guess, Scott, I would say that ultimately I'm going to be asking whether you calculated that in, so just giving you a little heads up.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay. Thank you. Then.
Yes.
You swear or affirm the testimony about to give this board is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Please state your name and spell it for us.
Yes. Scott Kennel, K-E-N-N-E-L, with McDonough and Ray Associates, 1431 Lakewood Road, Manasquan.
Mr. Kennel, will you please state your qualifications?
Sure. I'm a partner with McDonough and Ray Associates, a traffic and transportation consulting firm. I have over 35 years of traffic and transportation planning experience throughout New Jersey. I've prepared over 500 traffic impact studies. I've testified in over 100 municipalities. I've testified before this board.
Well, I think before you accept his credentials, I think we have one board member who wants to state
Chairman,
something.
It's my understanding that under the Municipal Land Use Act that the individual has to be a licensed professional engineer in the state. Mr. Cachero, could you weigh in on this, please?
Yeah. So Municipal Land Use only speaks to permitting expert testimony. Mr. Kennel is not a licensed professional engineer in any state. He doesn't have that educational background. What I look to is the rules of evidence. And the rules of evidence state that if an individual possesses a level of knowledge and experience which is helpful to the trier of fact, that person or individual can be qualified as an expert. You can most certainly take into account the fact that Mr. Kennel is not an engineer when you weigh and balance his testimony. You can determine what weight you want to give it. So I would say, first of all, we would not be qualifying him as a traffic engineer. Be traveling him as a traffic professional. I think, incidentally, Mr. Kennel, can you just place on the record whether you've ever appeared in Superior Court and been accepted by the Superior Court as a traffic professional?
Yes, I've been qualified as a traffic expert in New Jersey Superior Court on three matters, two of them in Ocean County and a third matter in Mercer County on land use applications.
I can tell you that this issue has come up before, specifically with regard to Mr. Kennel. It is in litigation right now. here in Monmouth County that I'm involved in representing that particular board. So there may be a more definitive statement on it coming in the months to come. But I think that under our rules of evidence, you know, he need not be an actual licensed professional engineer.
Thank you.
So now, Mr. Chairman, after all that, the board can determine, you know, whether it wants to accept Mr. Kennel as a...
Yes, it will.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mr. Kennel, did you have the opportunity to do a traffic analysis for this project? And if so, would you please describe the results of your analysis to the board?
Yes. My firm prepared a traffic statement, impact statement, dated May 22, 2015, that was submitted to the board as part of this application. And that traffic analysis included, the first part would be an inventory of existing conditions, the conduct of traffic counts along Route 9, which were conducted in May of 2014, as well as in June of 2015 along Route 9. That included the installation of automatic traffic recording devices, as well as manual turning movement counts at the Casino Drive and Route 9 intersection and the Strickland Road and Route 9 intersection. The traffic statement did not go into an analysis of those intersections. They were part of the NJDOT access application and the NJDOT traffic study, which was submitted to the township in December of 2015 when we made an application to NJDOT. Once we have established the base traffic volumes, it was necessary to estimate traffic to be generated by the development. And we took into consideration input from NJDOT that was part of a pre-application meeting that was held in July of 2014. And based on NJDOT's definition of the buildings proposed on site, it's qualified and classified as a shopping center. And as a result, it was the shopping center traffic generation rates were utilized for the main building, and that would be for the first floor, for the two pad sites. And then as far as the second floor, it's very unusual to have a retail type use on the second floor. Typically, they're used for office space. So the analysis took into consideration the second floor as office space when developing traffic projections. Taking that into consideration, it was estimated that at the site driveway, the three buildings would generate approximately 284 inbound and outbound trips for the weekday PM peak hour. And then for the Saturday midday peak hour, which is historically the highest traffic generation period for a retail use or shopping center, it was projected to be 410 trips in and out. Now, that's not all new trips to the area. This type of development would incur what we call pass-by trips, traffic that's already on the roadway, whether it's an employment commuting trip or another shopping trip, and they would combine this with their other trip. And there was pass-by credits taken in accordance with ITE and NJDOT criteria. Once we have the traffic projections, then we developed a distribution model, which assign traffic to Route 9, to Casino Drive, to Strickland Road, as well to Wyckoff Mills Road. And that distribution model was reviewed and accepted by NJDOT. As far as the traffic statement, it qualified the level of service at the site driveway, and was determined that the exiting movements onto Route 9 would operate a level service D. And the uniqueness of this site, it takes advantage of the fact that they have the traffic signal at Casino Drive to the south. So that traffic signal meters or platoons the traffic in the northbound direction. So I see that as a significant benefit to where this site is located and in proximity to Casino Drive. And if you go out and visit the site, you'll experience that again, that traffic signal provides gaps and will allow the driver to operate in an efficient manner.
As far as NJDOT, let me touch on that before I speak to the site plan section. As I stated, we had a pre-application with NJDOT in July of 2014. A formal application was submitted in December 2015. We've had two reviews, and the most recent submission to NJDOT was on November 2, 2016. I would expect their comments back in the next 30 to 60 days, taking into consideration the time when we made the submission and the recent holidays and the like. So I would expect additional comments and hopefully an approval within 30 to 60 days. As it relates to the site plan, Mr. Stevens had talked about the, I guess I'll touch base on access since there's a question as far as the number of driveways. The initial proposal to NJDOT considered an ingress towards the southerly end of the site and an egress towards the northerly end of the frontage. And the initial thought process was that that would be the most efficient way to accommodate delivery vehicles, and they could circulate basically around the perimeter of the site without having to interact with the actual park and field. The response from NJDOT is they recommended and directed us to consider a single point of access with the right-in, right-out design as shown on the site plan. So just for the board's benefit, we did give consideration for multiple driveways. And by DOT definition, it would have still been considered a single driveway. We were just, it would have been a bifurcated with the ingress at the southerly end and the egress at the northerly end. But the thought process on as far as at the northerly end was the concern to the proximity to the Wyckoff Mills cutoff or access, and the reasoning for the single point of access is one, to have the egress as far south from that Wyckoff Mills Y-shaped intersection. And again, their preference was, given the proximity to Casino Drive, to have it a single point of access as we designed it. As Mr. Stevens testified, it's been designed to accommodate a WB50 wheelbase vehicle to enter and circulate around the site.
Can you clarify real quick the reasoning, DOT's reasoning for the single ingress and egress? You said there was, the reason was to have the egress closer to Casino. What does that do? Like, what's the benefit? I'm trying to figure out what the benefit is.
Well, again, they convey to us their preference. They're more definitive as far as the exiting movement being towards the northerly end. They wanted the driveway exiting movement to be located as far away from Wyckoff Mills as possible. And I don't have a scale for me, but we're approximately 400 to 500 feet from that exit movement to the right. The Gore area or Wyckoff Mills veers to the right.
I guess I just don't understand the benefit. I don't see how one single egress and ingress driveway, I don't see why that's better than two separate. I would think, as somebody who's not an expert in this area, that a one-way ingress, a one-way egress spaced about 100 feet apart, kind of like how we have it at the Wawa gas station up here. That just seems to me like a little more efficient.
I understand your comment, and again, initially we had suggested that type of concept, but given the facts of the adjoining intersections, this is a design that they had strongly recommended. It has been designed to, with a 30-foot wide driveway and the generous curb returns to accommodate the large wheelbase vehicles. It's my opinion, and based on a review of the truck turning plan prepared by Bill Stevens' office, that truck movements can be accommodated in a safe and efficient manner.
Mr. Kennel, is any portion of the frontage of this property covered by the DOT administrative control of access?
There are no
limits of access along this frontage, other than, again, on a technical basis, they could employ the corner clearance requirement from Wyckoff Road, and their corner clearance requirement is a minimum of 100 feet. But again, they were being sensitive to the existing conditions out here. For example, if someone was to make a right turn and they did not want to go on the Wyckoff Road, but they wanted to proceed further north on Route 9, this gives a exiting vehicle a better opportunity to access the two through lanes on Route 9.
All right, and I'd just like to circle back to your comment about the truck circulation. And I looked at the exhibit that was contained in the packet that Mr. Stevens has developed with the truck turning radius and the truck turning paths. And I would just like to have you comment about the interaction at the ingress and egress point about whether or not that larger wheelbase vehicle has to encroach into the opposing traffic lanes in order to turn into the site.
What this plan has shown, and again, it's for a WB50, which is for a shopping center such as this, that is not the typical delivery vehicle. They're generally the SU30, the smaller box trucks. However, we've taken consideration of WB50. The plan shows an encroachment. It's my sense that could be refined, and the turning path shows that it's probably a 5 to 10 foot offset from the curb, the inbound curb return. We could take another review of that to fine tune that so that the encroachment doesn't exist. NJDOT is currently reviewing these plans that you have before you, so we're awaiting their comments. They may come back and ask for a larger curb return to eliminate that encroachment that you speak of.
Taking it beyond that point, and I understand what you're saying, I mean, there's considerable amount of maneuvering of that truck through the site to access the loading area in the back of this. And this is absent of whatever loading is going to occur for the two pad sites. Do you still feel that, and these deliveries could potentially occur during the course of the day when there's vehicles parked in parking spaces, there's movements in and out of the stalls. Do you still feel that this is a good circulation plan?
It's my opinion that circulation plan works, that again, the nature of the, we basically have a circulation path that's generally in the perimeter of the parking field. And even on the northerly end, an alternate route could be one that instead of coming along the front of the stores, the site is designed where they could go to around the pad site so they don't have to use, circulate in front of the stores where the parking spaces. So I'd say there's an alternative route. We can revisit this plan and, you know, resubmit, you know, based on your concerns. And, you know, put more of a fine tune to it.
I would ask if you maybe could go back. I wouldn't even be adverse as to tightening up some of these radius to prevent the truck from circulating in front of the stores, but to force it to do that exterior circulation pattern.
We could accommodate that.
Let me just ask you a question as a follow-up to that. If the entrance and exit were changed to the original plan, would that change the circulation plan?
It would have adjustments to it where the vehicles entering the site would be more in the vicinity of the southerly pad site.
Mm-hmm.
There would still be generally the same kind of interaction.
Would it be more of a...
For entry movement to a somewhat lesser degree, but, you know, it's still consistent in character to what we're providing here.
Yeah. But the reason I ask is to follow up with Mr. Russo's concern. You know, when the applicant first designed this, it had two entrances. The DEP, in their infinite wisdom, has decided not to have two entrances. I don't think Ms. Keneally has any problem going back to the DEP, since this is still in review, if you will, by them, and express your concerns about, you know, exactly why are they going with one as opposed to two, and including comments about the circulation that may be affected by that also. You could do that, right?
I can revisit this with the NJDOT case manager. Correct?
Absolutely. So
we would appreciate that. Yeah. I know. I speak for myself, Mr. Nash. We would appreciate that.
No, we thought it was a better idea. So
my big concern is about the interaction right at as the trucks enter the site and exit the site, and the conflicts with the opposing movement of traffic, and I think the separate ingress and egress would obviously eliminate that conflict.
Now, if you did have the separate ingress egress, you would need to do the one way around the back, right?
Mm-hmm. It would continue to be one way around the easterly side of the building, and the ingress would in all likelihood be located just north of the southerly pad site, so they'd have a direct shot to the back of the main building. And then you would just have an exit where the current driveway is shown now. It would not be an entrance. It would only be exit only there.
Okay, so the current ingress, egress, single driveway would be the new egress.
It would be egress.
And then the ingress would be, I guess, I don't know.
Towards Casino Drive, north, on the north side of the southerly pad site.
Would it be in front of the proposed one-story?
Correct.
Okay, I see.
So that you'd have a straighter shot to the back of the main building.
And the egress would obviously be, it wouldn't be just that
it would just curve. Be for exit.
It would be a straight shot, kind of like almost like a mini merge onto Route 9, right?
Correct. It's only giving me exit only. It wouldn't be an entrance. They have, NJDOT has criteria as far as number of driveways permitted. Mm-hmm. They're entitled to grant you an ingress and egress, whether it's separated or as one driveway, as we have here. This site would be entitled to an additional driveway, but the bar is raised generally pretty high for them to grant additional driveways unless they could see where it benefit the Route 9 traffic. And based on my experience, they want to minimize the number of curb cuts, as few curb cuts as possible onto the state highway.
Let me just follow up on that with the two curb cuts. In your experience with driver's reaction, if they miss that first so-called entrance, do you see them braking, believing that egress out onto Route 9 is another entrance?
Well, again, as was stated earlier, it's not unusual for a divided roadway to have a driveway system with a separate ingress and egress. I think the other thing that would be a benefit that wasn't available as, you know, 10, 15 years ago is the fact that people use GPS and technology, which typically advises people that, okay, your destination is 500 feet. Yeah.
Makes them also turn right onto railroad tracks also.
Well, but we also here have great sight lines on this section, Route 9. It's a pretty straight section. And this type of site is also going to, is it more of a neighborhood center? So you're going to have customers here on a regular basis. You will have some transient activity, but it's pretty much to serve the neighborhood and the surrounding area. So people are going to be familiar with the ingress and egress.
So you talked about your capacity analysis that you did for the egress, and you said it was level of service D. Now, you know level of service D is a range, all right? Could you give us more exacting figures? Was it upper level of D? Was it the threshold of DE?
Give me a second, I will... That exact calculation's not here, but in my recollection, it was in the range of 40 seconds. And there was no, that was based on the traffic volumes without taking consideration for the gaps created by Casino Drive, so it was a worst-case scenario.
Well, as you know, that can go both ways. I mean, yes, I agree with you, it provides more gaps when the light goes red on Route 9, but conversely, it requires the vehicles on the site to wait that whole cycle to get the red on Route 9, which is, you know, more delay. So, I understand.
And I agree, and this is no different from other commercial developments along the Route 9 corridor, whether it's in Howell or Freehold Township.
So, your trip generation, you indicated that the second story, or the upper level, whatever you want to call it, of these retail establishment, you use as a trip generation rate for office and not retail.
That's correct.
If you happen to use the 7,200 square feet as a retail, the retail would have a higher trip generation rate, is that correct?
That is correct.
And how would that impact, without having to do hard calculations, but how would that impact your level of service?
It's my opinion we'd still be at a level of service D. But I can't right at this moment provide you what the differential will be. But I'm still confident it would be a level of service D. Again, the thought process here is it's very unusual to have a retail use on a second floor. I mean, just the retailers need to be convenient and accessible, and usually through a storefront. My experience is these type of developments, especially this size building, it's generally office space that is in the second floor. So that's the rationale we took here, and that was accepted by NJDOT in discussing the application.
But if I'm understanding from our professionals, there's nothing that would preclude that from being second floor retail.
If someone can market that as retail, I'm sure my client would be very happy, because it's a different rental rate than office space.
All right. And going back to your trip generation rate, now you combine the two pads and you use the shopping center trip generation rate. What would happen if you pulled the two pads out as a fast food and use those as the trip generation rates for that applicable square footage?
Well, obviously the trip generation would be greater if you looked at every single individual use on a site. That is not consistent with the ITE methodology for, again, I'll call it a shopping center. I know we'll have a different discussion later on in parking. But what happens here is you have a multiple tenants, multiple users. There's interaction with them. There are people who will patronize a restaurant and then possibly another retailer or tenant within the development. And they also have different peaking characteristics. I mean, typically fast food's peak period is midday versus late afternoon, where the retailers would have a greater traffic generation. So it takes all into consideration the synergy, the multi-purpose trips that exist with a multi-tenant retail development. And again, that's the direction and that NJDOT had given us in preparing the traffic study.
Okay, thank you.
I guess the next item, we'll jump into parking. As was testified earlier.
Excuse me.
Sorry.
Through the chair. I may ask a question.
Sure.
You proposing two fast food restaurants. Many fast food restaurants have a drive-up window. That has not been addressed yet.
excuse me, addressed in which fashion?
Well, probably in site circulation.
In the circulation.
I mean, there are queuing issues when you're dealing with a drive-through and general, you know, circulation issues for the site.
So the question pertains to the stacking and queuing that we're providing?
Well, I think overall circulation. How would that impact your prior testimony if the two restaurants had drive-throughs?
That's based on how I reviewed this plan. It's been detailed as two drive-through restaurants, and I evaluated this site based on that premise or based on how the plan's been prepared. So as a result, my testimony as far as on-site circulation remains relative to the having two fast food restaurants on site.
And the plan shows the drive-through lanes?
Yes, they do.
Okay, so then do you want to talk a little bit about how you took queuing into account when you were analyzing the circulation?
Generally, for a drive-through restaurant, you want to provide 6 to 8 parking spaces, 6 to 8 vehicles. And we have, on the northerly one, we have stacking for 6 vehicles. And on the southerly one, again, they don't have tenants. These are kind of generic footprints. So I don't have exact pickup window locations. But if I were to... Based on assuming that the pickup window would be midpoint of the southerly building, you'd have stacking for 6 vehicles for that restaurant itself. Based on my experience, it is likely that these footprints would change and the pickup windows would be further to the east. That would increase the stacking. But again, these are generic. We don't have known tenants. I mean, the footprints don't even delineate pickup windows. So based on what we have here, I'm estimating approximately 6 vehicles. The building pickup windows could be adjusted to where you provide 8 vehicles in queuing.
So those dotted or crosshatched lines, that's painted surface on that part of that parking lot?
That's correct.
And that's the same area that a delivery truck would have to come in with the perimeter circulation to get to the back of the building? The restaurant at the northern end of the property?
That is correct.
Those drawings for a vehicle to be able to get through there is based on the 40-foot width with that radius or the lesser width with vehicles waiting in a pickup window? Can't imagine a truck being able to make that turn if there's vehicles waiting to pick up food.
The document submitted does not have, we have to, again, we're going to refine the truck turning plan for the northerly pad site, but it'll be designed to accommodate a delivery vehicle without encroaching onto the drive-through lane.
But good. But if you stated before that the entrance would be near Casino Drive, that would have to take up some of those parking spots that are existing there, I would believe. Then those cars would have to come around and go around the other fast food restaurant. I mean, it doesn't look like there's enough space to do that.
If they entered the site at that location, they would enter onto the site, and then at the first, I'll say, north-south drive aisle, they can make a left and then traverse to the northerly end of the site, or They enter the site to the front of the main building, make a left turn, and then access the drive-through, the other restaurant, if that's their destination.
Well, you're saying that you have to submit that as future testimony anyway, regardless of what it shows right now, right?
That's correct. We were going to go back and revisit this plan, correct.
So to that point, not to jump ahead too far, but I don't see how you could possibly expect to get final on the main building tonight because one thing affects the other, right?
I have a funny feeling. I don't want to share that coming
back. I just want to throw that out there.
To that specific question, and based on some of the concerns that the board has evidenced tonight that the applicant would like to address, formally I'm going to amend the application from a request for preliminary and final to preliminary on the site. There's a number of issues that are outstanding.
It being 10 o'clock now, I don't see how we can give you a preliminary final. We have a whole group of people that want to testify. I don't see how we can do this without you coming back and having the public come back.
Of course.
Well, I think, Mr. Chair, I think what Mr. Woters said in the first instance was they're no longer seeking final.
Right.
So I think what you're talking about tonight is whether we can even finish, based upon the testimony that's still left from the applicant, our questions, the board professionals' questions, the testimony, and perhaps some of the follow-up that they have to do even for the preliminary.
That's exactly what
right.
I'm saying.
So that's what the chairman is saying, Mr. Woters.
Yes, but I want the board to understand that we are not going
to
seek.
We understand.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we understand.
The chairman was just saying he didn't know whether we could finish preliminary tonight.
I agree.
Yeah. So then, Mr. Chair, I think the applicant has some revisiting to do and questions and follow-up to come back with, and I think that would be helpful anyway for members of the public to have an updated testimony rather than presenting and asking questions.
We're more than willing to come back and try to answer some of the questions that you've questioned.
I do want to apologize to the public, but we want to hear each and every one of you, and we know that some of your questions are going to be detailed and lengthy, and we're not going to be sitting here until...
The other thing, Mr. Chairman, is that the questions and comments would be to unfinished testimony. Mm-hmm. So they would, it would have to be two rounds, essentially, right. Because you'd have to come back up after the second round. So it would be comprehensive to hear all of it and then comment on the complete testimony. Okay.
Mr. Chair, just if I may. Laura, has anyone in your office, traffic expert, looked at this circulation? I mean, this is a topic of contention, and would it be advisable that our professionals...
We can certainly have our traffic expert look at that, yes.
Okay.
And we'll have ours talk to yours in advance of the next meeting.
Okay, so then... Counselor, do we have a date for them to come back to your public?
Mr. Woters, to track down some of the additional information and do whatever you need to do, how long do you think you would need for that to happen?
Well, unfortunately, Mr. Stevens is not available on the 19th.
Mm-hmm.
So what's the next available meeting after that?
It'd be the first... Thursday in February. February 2nd.
February 2nd.
What do we got to do? We got to get back to the DOT.
I'm not available on the 2nd.
Okay. What's next?
Probably need more time. Anyway.
Okay. Especially if we're going to talk to the DOT. So, DOT rather. John, hey.
16th the next?
Yeah, Calvin.
Since we've got to go back to the DOT, is there a possible? How about the 16th?
That's fine. We don't have anything scheduled the 16th.
Okay.
That's a good night.
That'd be good.
All right, so then, Mr. Chairman. So the application, I'm sorry.
We're not finished, are we?
Yeah, we're wrapping up.
The application of SL Homes, Inc., case number SP-101, we carry to the board's February 16th, 2017 meeting, 7 o'clock here in the main meeting room. There'll be no further notice to property owners. So if you received a notice for tonight's hearing, you will not receive another one. This is your notice to come back on the 16th. You're also, any member of the public is free to come visit Eileen in the planning department during normal business hours if you want to look at the plans or any of the submissions. And anything that's supplementally submitted would be in Eileen's office also if anyone wants to come down.
So, I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman, we've had some members of the public that have waited patiently, and I understand that we're continuing this, but do we know, I suspect at least one member of the public has met with some of our staff and addressed some concerns. In order to not delay it even further, meaning that person would come and speak at the next meeting and then have to wait another period of time to get some issues addressed, have those items been brought forth to you so that when we do have public comment, you would be able to address them at that second hearing?
Yes.
Okay. I'm fine with that.
I'm fine with that.
Okay. Then we would just need a motion to adjourn, Mr. Chair.
You're not being fair to the public.
So moved.
You're violating our rights.
I'll second that.
All in favor?
Aye.